How's it going, everybody, and welcome back to Lead Therapy, and thank you so very much for taking time for tuning into my video. On Tuesday, November 9th, approximately 20 federal agents, some with guns drawn, raided Skelton Tactical in Osage Beach. And if you want to know where Osage Beach is, it's in Missouri, and the reason they call it Osage Beach is because it's on a lake. The owner of Skelton Tactical is Jim Skelton, and he has a brother named Ike Skelton, who owns a locksmith business in an adjoining building. Before I get on with this video, if you enjoyed the video or if I gave you some information you didn't know, please like, share, and subscribe and hit those post notifications. You guys have been doing a fantastic job in doing so, and it's greatly appreciated. Ike Skelton, who is the brother of Jim Skelton, who owns the gun shop, spoke on radio as well as Lakes TV Burnin' with KB Show, which is from part of the video that I'm going to show you that is found on YouTube. And the channel's name is Lake TV. Please take time to watch Ike Skelton's video because he has a really good message at the end of it. Plus, I have some additional information.
Hey, welcome back to What's Burning here on Lake TV, KB, and some interesting developments here in the Lake area in recent days. On Tuesday, November the 9th, Skelton Tactical in Osage Beach was raided by the ATF. And citing various reasons for the raid, they came in force. 20 ATF officers in tactical gear showed up and basically went through the facility with a fine-tooth comb, taking some firearms, confiscating the firearms, I should say, to the tune of about 365 firearms. And if you just put, let's say, $500 on each firearm as far as value, that totals up somewhere in the neighborhood of about $180,000. The owner is Jim Skelton. His brother is Ike Skelton, and Ike joins me on What's Burning. Ike, great to see you.
Thank you for having me, KB.
Let's talk a little bit about the situation that occurred, because you were just doing your daily business.
Just came in normal like every other day, you know, and sat down and kind of got getting the day going. I had some keys that I needed to make that early and get early and back to some folks. And right about 8:30, here comes my brother, and there was a gentleman that came in, just a friend, to talk. But here comes these individuals. I noticed from right through the window. We have a window in the front, and he had the tactical gear on, and helmet, ballistic helmet, the whole nine yards, M4 full automatic rifles. M4s are kind of distinct. And they came in. A couple of them had weapons drawn. They didn't point them at us or anything of that nature. But they did come in force, at least eight deep, just in that particular portion of it all. And they told us to stay right where we were, nobody move. And they begin to tell us that they are going to effect a search warrant. They have a search warrant for Skelton Tactical. And I wanted to pick up my phone because I was stunned.
Right.
I had no clue. Mm-hmm. And of course, that's the way they want it to be, you know. So I picked up my phone. I was like, well, I got to record this. This is crazy because, you know, this day and age, we need to have that evidence, you know, for ourselves. Mm-hmm. I mean, because look, you want to think that these folks are doing truly what they're supposed to be doing. But I think we've seen in this country now, especially the last several years, that they're not quite as pure as the wind-driven snow as I might think. So I wanted to record this, and they took my camera, put it down on the counter, said, no, I cannot record it. Mm-hmm. I tried to grab it again. They were a little more forceful about things at that point, and then started asking me about whether we had any firearms behind my counter.
Physically or vocally forceful?
Vocally. They didn't physically do anything to me until they commanded me to stand up, and you know, I told them there's no firearms here. I carry my sidearm for self-protection. I have a CCW, concealed carry permit, mm-hmm. So I carry. And he wanted to know that, and I told him I'm armed and made me stand up, took my weapon from me, emptied it, left it lying there, frisked me, and told me they were going to search our building too. And there's a little separation of those two buildings. I don't get into a whole lot of detail, and we don't have a lot of time, but so they were going to search it. They made me and my apprentice go outside. We were not allowed in the building anymore. And we went through a few different things that finally allowed me back into my building to do my job, because I protested mm-hmm. Rather heavily to all of it, what was going on. Obviously, I didn't have much of a leg to stand on, but I tried. You know, I told them that their warrant doesn't cover my side of the building, and I told them some things, and I think they maybe agreed, because we wound up in a situation where I could come back into the building. But they did do a search of my side of the building as well. I had some firearms in there in a back room that I told them about, and they took all of those weapons, laid them on my brother's side, closed the cage that he has there, and nobody could get in there again.
Let's kind of try to determine what the issue was. What brought the ATF in force to Skelton Tactical?
So what brought them to do what I'm about to explain that they did, I don't know. I don't know what the precursor was. In legal parlance, you could say maybe what was not probable cause, but what was even the reasonable suspicion to go to probable cause. So there was a man and a woman came into the shop, and they looked around at several different weapons. They grabbed an old Craig Jorgensen. They grabbed some other weapons that they wanted, and my brother started to fill out the paperwork. Mm-hmm. He had each individual form just like you're supposed to, and she started, the female started filling out all the paperwork. Well, unbeknownst to him, they were both federal agents.
Right.
And so they filled out, the lady filled out the paperwork, and on that form, that federal form, it says, are you the actual purchaser of the firearm? And she answered yes on every one of those forms. Okay. So in reality, to the way they look at it, she actually falsified the documents. Mm-hmm. To entrap him, I believe. So then after they get all the paperwork done, she gets a background check and everything's all set up and done. Jim hands over the weapons, and the man then pulls the money out of his pocket and pays my brother for the weapons. Mm-hmm. So what they're saying is that man bought the weapons and not the woman that filled out the form.
I wonder, though, has anyone ever purchased a weapon for someone else as a gift, maybe? That kind of sounds a little sketchy to me.
Well, I don't know if I should answer that at this point because you don't know, I don't know anymore. Yeah. I don't know. I just don't. So let me ask you this. How many times have you gone into any store with your wife and the wife picks something else off? Oh, I'd like to have this. And she puts it at the counter. Oh, let me get that for you, sweetheart. You grab your money and you pay for it.
Right.
Now, are you the purchaser or did she want it?
I guess it depends on the item.
Well, I suppose it is.
Obviously, apparently it does in this case.
It does in this case, yet she lied on the form. Now, there have been other folks that came into the shop and filled out that form and said, no, they weren't. They weren't buying it for themselves, and he refused the sale.
Right.
So if she would have been honest on that form, he would have refused the sale, and we wouldn't be here today.
So they come in, they confiscate all of these weapons, and it sounded like they were pretty serious about things. What do you think as far as the way it was handled? Was there a need, I guess in their mind, the ATF decided to bring in all of these officers, agents, whatever you want to call them, in tactical gear, I guess to send some sort of a message?
Well, certainly to make you know that they're there seriously. Don't try to resist them. Don't bother with what they're doing. And, to me, it just harkens on the big arm of the government. I mean, we've talked about various times, look what they've done to other people around the country for no reason whatsoever, bringing all this tactical gear and equipment and armored vehicles.
Roger Stone.
Yes, absolutely. I think it's just another way for the federal government to say, we are bigger than you, we're more powerful than you, and do not resist.
Speaking of the warrant, did you get to really sit down and read through it?
No, as a matter of fact, I didn't get a copy of it. I didn't get to see it at all.
Yeah.
They showed it to him, to my brother Jim, through the gate that's there, if you've been in the shop, and they showed it to him, and they explained what they're going to do. And it's very vague, like most search warrants, and I guess when it comes to the ATF and firearms, they can pretty much steal anything they want to take from you. Mm-hmm. My sister-in-law told me this morning that they actually wound up taking his sticky notes that he had on the desk.
Nice.
So they've taken the computer, they've taken any kind of electronic recording device, anything of that nature. Like I said, the sticky notes, all of his paperwork, all of his forms, even tablets and anything that he had written notes in for whatever reason. They took all of that stuff. They've taken all of it. So I'd imagine they'll go through that with a fine-tooth comb and see if they can't find something that is more egregious.
What, if any, direction do you have at this particular point as far as pursuing legal representation? Mm-hmm. Have you talked to anyone from the ATF? Have they reached out to you to explain to you what your options are?
They gave Jim a big packet of paper that I guess he's going to have to fill out to try to get this stuff back. I don't know the procedures. Mm-hmm. I'm sure it's going to be incredibly costly. We're going to have an attorney that is certified for federal court action and can talk about those things. If there's a takeaway here, I mean, obviously Jim wants his property back.
Right.
I mean, it's his property. So we want to get that back. And everybody, I think, in Camden County knows Osage Beach. First of all, you have to be squeaky clean to get the license to begin with,
right?
Jim is not a lawbreaker. I'm not a lawbreaker. So where they come up with the reason to actually come out and do this, I just don't get it. But there's something I would, I want folks to know that there is a time in this country that we're going to have to stand up and just say no, that we're not going to deal with these things anymore.
Ike first told the ATF agents there were no guns in his shop. Then he turns around and tells them he's carrying concealed, and then later on tells them there's some firearms in the back room. After I made the first part of this video, I then read another article saying the paperwork that the ATF agents gave to the gun shop owner said they had at least 200 violations. But the gun store owner, Jim Skelton, said he's only had his business for 3 years, and after he had his original interview with the ATF, he has never seen an agent since then. So if it is true he has at least 200 violations, how is he supposed to know if nobody told him? Also, in another story, they say an undercover agent purchased one of the gun store owner's personal firearms out of his truck without a background check. And that was not mentioned during the interview. I'm very interested to read your guys' comments in the comments section down below about this story. And as I mentioned at the starting of the video, if you enjoyed the video or if I gave you some information you didn't know, please like, share, and subscribe and hit those post notifications. And I'll see you guys in the next video.